Back to Nat's Quiz.
Nat's Quiz. Today, yeah.
Joining with me is my roommate, my friend, James and Kraus. And that's it. No Jake today.
It's sad but true.
It is.
I feel like part of my soul is missing, but that's okay. Well, we'll pretend to be happy and record an episode anyway.
It's fine.
Yeah.
It's fine. No, in this bonus episode, Jamie and I, quite a while back.
Yeah.
It might have been
a few months ago, yeah.
It must have been a while. We were staying up late and we were just chatting about the music of Night's Quest, and Jamie was explaining a whole bunch of hidden things he had put in there.
Right. It was mostly just me babbling about it because I get really excited about it because there's a lot of random details and stuff that I don't really have like an organic place to talk about that in a way that doesn't just sound like randomly, hey, you guys want to hear about my music?
Hey, you want to hear about my music?
Yeah, it just doesn't really fit in most conversations.
So, I thought it was a really great conversation. I was like, hold up, we gotta stop. We should have been recording this the whole time. Which we weren't.
Right.
So then we're like, well, you know, let's make this a bonus episode. And then that's what we're doing right now.
It's true.
And now you're listening to it. So what we're gonna do is we're gonna go through the music of season one.
Season one.
Which, hopefully, by the point this episode comes out, all of the season one music will be on Bandcamp for you to listen to and buy.
Editor's note, album number 5 is done. You can all go listen to it over on Bandcamp.
The fifth album, which, because it's not finished yet, I'm still not 100% sure if it'll be one album or if it'll be a weird, cool, double part album.
Editor's note, it's just going to be one really big album.
That is in the works.
As we record, but when you listen to it, it's done.
Oh, yeah, it's probably done, yeah.
Yeah, for you, it's done. Wow.
Oh,
hope
God,
you like
it's
it.
It's the future past thing.
Oh, this timeline shit's good. It gets me every time. Anyway, either it'll be a one-part album or a two-part album,
right.
But it'll all be there. So what we want you guys to do is, obviously, listen to our conversation, but if you're like, hey, I want to hear the thing they talked about, the music is all available.
You can hear the thing.
You can do it.
Yeah.
You can go listen to it. So if you want to listen to the music along with us, it's Night's Quest Official. .bandcamp.com and all the music
right
from season one is right there,
and that's spelled exactly how it sounds, Bandcamp. So
Bandcamp, yep. Yeah, some of you have already found your way there and given us your dollars, and we appreciate that. So all right, but now let's get to the meat of it. So the music begins
right
technically in episode 3,
I think so,
but that's not our music,
right?
That's the music
yeah
that I definitely I plagiarized, and if we ever get in trouble, that's why.
Right. That was during the celebration.
Yeah, the performance in town.
Right.
So what we had done is we had recorded, you know, a stockpile of episodes, and right before we released, I was like, hey Jamie, I know that you're a musical genius. And I was like, would you want to make like a theme song for us?
Right. The theme song was the very first thing, which kind of makes sense, yeah.
And Jamie was like, yeah. And so he, should we listen to it right now?
yeah, sure, we could. That's when I started trying to learn GarageBand from scratch. and that's the reason. Should I just leave it playing?
Yeah, this is fine. Okay, I'll also have the music playing behind us while we talk and just point out anything during the song of interest.
There's, let's see here. I'm trying to think of anything about this first track specifically. I had mostly finished writing it. I don't know if I've actually talked about this before. I had mostly finished writing it when I realized that the main theme is actually really, really similar to a song that my brother wrote for a totally unrelated thing. So I don't feel like I have to apologize to him, but I sometimes feel that way because it's a little close. And I didn't do it on purpose. The song was, like, mostly finished when I thought of that. Oh, no. That's me playing for real. I'm sure I've already said that.
Yeah, so that's you playing the ocarina for real life at the end, as it is with every iteration of the theme song. You always play it at the end.
Yes, the theme song, the ocarina at the end of all the different theme song variants, that's always me. The one with, like, kind of an echo behind it, obviously that's just me playing two different times and syncing them together. Yep.
That's close. Now, I remember when I first heard this song, I genuinely was like, this is it.
Oh,
this is
epic. Man.
This is dope. Cool. I think I gave you a couple notes.
Oh, yeah.
We had a couple versions.
Oh, for sure. There's older versions.
I don't even remember what the tweaks were, but for the most part, I was like, I listened to it on repeat, and I could just, like, feel the adventure coming out of it. So I was like, this is great. This is amazing.
I bet if I looked around, I could find the older drafts, but that might take a while.
So anyway, we had that ready to go before episode one was ever published.
That's true, man.
So as we were going, I was like, Jamie, I would love if we had some music for, like, the Ba's al Ghul scene.
Yeah, yeah.
And just because I knew that would be it was a big moment that music could really, like, really accent. And so you started making the music for when we entered into the mine.
Yeah. What's funny is that we agreed on that, like, oh, shoot, I should, like, let's do that. Let's work on music for episode 8, which is the big Ba's al Ghul thing. And I started a couple of songs. I think the one where we're coming out and, like, it's a very emotional moment, and we're, like, kind of getting our bearings, like, what the fuck just happened? I started working on that one way early. But at the time, we were only on episode 5 in the ones that were being released.
Right?
So while I was working on that, I was like, this is fun. I kind of want to do more of this. So
that's when he got addicted.
Yeah. And I was like, well, what's the next one that's going to come out? And it was episode 5, which happens to be the one where we fight the Rock Boys. Mm-hmm. So I just jumped into it way too recklessly and ended up writing, like, way too much stuff.
Let's listen to a little bit of that. Yeah. We don't have to listen to the whole thing, but, like, part of it.
Yeah, the Rock Boys fight is, I believe, that was the first song I actually finished, outside of the theme, obviously. But I think this was the first one where, like, I actually got the whole thing done, and I was like, this is where I want it, let's use it, put it in, let's go. And I'm sure it wasn't hard to notice that this song has come back, like, 3 different times.
Yeah, this is, like, our combat song now.
Because we don't have many. We don't have a ton of big fight scenes. So when a really important fight scene comes up, quite a few times I have just tweaked this song. The biggest one that comes to mind is probably when we fought the eagle. It's this track slowed down a lot in a new key. Obviously there's a lot of little things added in for how that particular fight went. Like, the amulet gets spun, I think. There's, like, people getting stabbed and stuff. So I had to do a lot of tweaks, a lot of, differences. But, it's basically just this song.
this is our fight song.
For sure. Same thing happened in season 2, I think, with the young Reese.
It came back.
Oh, yeah.
It came back. It's when you know it's a real fight. It's when the Rock Boys theme comes. I guess it's the combat theme.
Yeah. Definitely, I would agree with that.
Now, Jamie and I, we're both fans of motifs, just in general, for, like, music and things, so I always appreciate when Jamie...
Just quiet that down there.
when Jamie includes more motifs, and whenever I catch one, like sometimes I'll be editing an episode and I'll be like, I recognize this one. Where was it from? When did he use it before? Fuck.
Right, oh, right.
I'm missing a cool moment. So hopefully we'll be able to highlight a couple of those things.
Yeah.
Also, if you go back to the early episodes, we were not as good at leveling the music.
No.
They were way too loud.
Oh, certainly that. I guess that, but what I thought when you said that was like in the actual writing of the music itself.
That too, yeah.
Thinking, will this fit well behind narration and dialogue and stuff like that? And looking back, it definitely doesn't do that.
Yeah, it's a little too distracting.
It's definitely distracting. And the only way to fix that is to lower the volume a lot.
Mm-hmm.
But that doesn't work super well because then you can't hear the music. Right, yeah. So it was an experiment, and it didn't work perfectly all the time. But I think we're getting a lot better at both sides of that.
Yes. Yeah.
Which is one thing that's been so fun about working on this show. Because the quality of the music, at least in my opinion, has gotten a lot better. And I think that finding the way to make the two audios work together, I think that's been really interesting and really fun. So
now, before we can leave the caves, the mine,
yep.
I think we gotta play the Chubb theme.
I would love to.
Because this was a song that I was like, Jamie, we don't need a theme for everything in this whole thing.
Yeah.
But it turned out we needed it.
It's us against all odds. This theme has come back. I genuinely don't know why I wrote this. Yeah, there we go. It's a very distinct sound. It's like one of the first things I found on GarageBand. So pretty much every time that comes up, you know what? I don't know if I should say that. I think that wispy, airy sound only ever comes up for the floating rocks, but it's possible I've used it in other stuff. I'm not sure. But yeah, it was just kind of this odd attitude of like, I don't think I wrote it because it was an important moment. I think I just really liked the idea of having cool, weird music in the background while we found a cool, weird, mysterious thing. Mm-hmm. Like, this is just going to work super well for ambiance. I don't know if I should have committed myself to saying this is the theme of Floating Rocks, because that's very dumb. And there's way more important things in our story that don't have a theme.
Yeah. No, let's talk about characters that don't have a motif.
Oh, most characters.
Leroy.
Almost all of the characters.
Rainer.
Jonathan. Katrina kinda does.
She eventually got one.
Yeah.
Rourke has one
for sure. It's weird because all of the characters that were introduced before
for
episode
music.
5.
Yeah.
Right. Don't have a motif exactly, even though they're the most important parts of the story.
Right, right.
So very random little things like the floating rocks, or Noble Mincer technically has a theme, but that was introduced way later on.
Didn't Chubb the Dog also get Chubb the Rock's theme?
Maybe? I'm not sure. It definitely shows up later on in season 1. But I don't remember why. Yeah, I have episode 28, scene-Chubb. And then I also have...
yeah, that would be before the dog.
I also have this called Yeah, Sure, Why Not from episode 33. And I think Leroy, like, in Coasterine, summoned the rock back to him or something? What happened there?
Like, yeah, what was episode 33?
Episode 33. We're definitely in Coasterine by that point.
At least just getting there.
And somehow, through magical means, I believe the
so
rock
33
comes
is
back.
City nightlife. That's when they first arrive in the city.
Right. I'm pretty sure the rock somehow comes back. And that might be even the same time.
Oh, maybe
time
that
period.
Was when Murgic made it float again?
Oh, yeah. That's probably what I'm thinking of.
Maybe.
And that might be around the same time that we named the dog Chubb.
No, that was even later.
Oh, boy.
That was even later after Leroy lost his memory.
Oh, you're right. That makes sense, yeah.
Okay, let's keep...
Damn.
We're still in the mines. Are there any other songs from that time that you think, you know, there's some cool stuff in there to mention?
Let's see. That was... that was the first time that the Mother's Lullaby theme came in, because...
Where he plays it to Ra's al Ghul.
No, but even before that, there's a scene where Katrina... We cut away from the mine, and Katrina is in the house.
Her.
And, yeah, at this point, the song was just called Her. Later on, this would become the same theme as Mother's Lullaby. Rainer and Katrina kind of share that song now, because this version of it is, like, specifically for Celeste, but, obviously Rainer ended up with a very similar song for the official Mother's Lullaby that he plays on the thing, and there's even a major version of it that became Bjorn's theme called Him, and then... a much more chill version that just became the home theme of Goldon. It's not well organized, you guys. It's a mess. Like,
our motifs are not lined up.
No, I wish they were. And, like, I love using them. I love the different ways they've iterated, and I'm really happy with how it turned out. But also, at the same time, trying to remember what's what is... I have made it a... disaster for myself.
When we restart in season 4, we'll have to have a cleaner motif library.
Right, it'll be very specific. You'll know exactly what's what.
Yeah.
My God, it's such a mess.
Until then, we just like the sound of this one, put it in there.
Yeah, same time period, I inexplicably gave PB his own theme.
Which is good.
It's fun.
PB became a key character.
Oh, yeah. No, that little bit has come back a lot.
That little trill?
Yeah.
Doo-doo-doo.
Oh, yeah.
That's from the theme, right?
Yeah. Well, I put it into the theme for season 2.
Oh, shit.
Yeah. I think later on in the song. There's a bunch of different parts of this song.
You skipping around through these songs is going to make it so much harder for me to edit them back into.
Shit, I can just play the whole thing. It's like 3 minutes, though.
It's too late.
A lot of these songs are also very basic because I was just learning how to use music software. That's why a lot of the... You'll notice there's no sense of echo in any of the actual... What is the word I'm looking for? Any of the instrumentation in these songs. Even though we're in a cave, we're in a giant mine... Nothing echoes in the music, and that's because I literally hadn't figured out how to do that yet. Now I do know how to do that, so again, in my opinion, a lot of the later music has a lot more fuller sound because there's, like, added effects. I figured out how to individually change the volumes of different tracks and even different notes, so in a lot of ways, it has gotten much, much better. So even though I love a lot of the melodies and a lot of the ideas for some of these earlier songs, there's also a lot of room for improvement. I mean, there still is, but especially with these older ones, I can instantly hear, like, oh, I would have done that different. I would have made that a lot cleaner.
Yeah, I can do the same for just normal editing.
Yeah.
Okay, I just heard the start of a song, I think.
This is 13 seconds long. We had the theme for PB that has do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do, right? So when we found a bunch of bats... I just made this. It's just the same thing, but with a bunch of extra shit. Like, and I was like, you guys, I'm so clever, you guys. I'm such a good songwriter. Oh my God, I'm so talented.
We're still in, like, episode 7. It's been almost 20 minutes.
It was pretty embarrassing, yeah.
So we end up Ra's al Ghul scene. We actually don't have a ton of music for that actual scene.
We do before that. There's a scene for climbing down the giant crazy stairway.
Oh, I know, but not actually like Ra's al Ghul himself.
That's correct, yes.
Because we also weren't as good as prioritizing the soundtracks.
Not. Yep.
Because you would just
agree with that.
Write them in order, right?
Yeah. Like episode 7, there's like 10 different tracks here. And that, if I remember right...
That was the riddles.
Yep, there were a whole bunch of stuff for the riddles in the riddle room. And I think, like, at that time, I was not doing a good job of managing this project and, like, coming up with a reasonable schedule for how much work and time am I going to put in to each of these episodes, right? So the result of that was that when we got to episode 8, and I was like, this has got to be super important and super cool and super big, I like did not give myself nearly enough time.
Mm-hmm.
So there's only three pieces, and only one of them is in the scene with Ba's al Ghul. The other two are actually after that. So it wasn't a great use of a great allocation, I should say, of like, how much am I going to work on? Where is it going to go? What's the priority going to be? Again, I like to think that has gotten better. There's been ups and downs, obviously, but it's really, for season two especially, I think that paradigm changed a lot. So what that leaves us with here in episode 8 is that there's the big complicated song that is both Rainer playing and also the sound of all the magical shit happening. But that's it. The rest of the scene, there's, like, no music.
And so that's the end of the first album.
Yep.
Unless you want to talk about any, like, Sunset or her and him a little more.
I don't think so. Sunset, I drew on a little bit for some stuff later on in the season. But, I mean, everybody knows the Mother's Lullaby part of this. So that's...
Is this you playing it, too?
Yes. The louder of the two, that is the higher, that is me playing it for real, but it's not nearly as impressive as it sounds, because I would play, like, two notes and stop, and then record myself playing another note or another two notes and stop. You guys, I don't know how to play ocarina. It's actually really pathetic. But then I would just string it all together in post, and I've gotten better at learning how to make that sound organic, so this... Even though just there, that was like 10 seconds of music, it took me like 20 takes. I had to just put it all together later. And the lower track, which I envision to be like, not to get too abstract here, but almost like the spirit of Rainer's mom playing as well, because it was her song, you know? That is just written digitally, and that's why it sounds so much better and so much cleaner. But I thought that worked well, too, because obviously she's a better musician than he is. So, like, I thought it kind of worked for her sound to be much more solid, much more cleaner. And while Rainer is playing over that, kind of struggling, to have the two differences there, I thought worked really well.
Now, we don't have any on the Bandcamp. We don't have any songs from episodes 9 or 10.
We do not.
Is that because we didn't have any, or just none of them were worth...
One of the two, I think 9, there was no music. I think I have this backwards. 10, there just wasn't any music.
I was just traveling.
Nine, the only music that we wrote for that was another fucking Careless Whisper cover. And I still am very hesitant. I just don't think I should put those in the albums, because, like, Bandcamp has a thing on their page that's like, hey, you cannot sell covers. Like, it's very specific. Does everyone follow that? I don't know. But I don't want to mess around and
you don't
find out.
Yeah. All right, so now the first one on the second album, Den of Thieves, is Ajax. Talk about these Ajax themes.
Yeah. It was super fun. I kind of wish I had done it differently, because in the episode, I wrote like 7 different songs. I mean, they're all the same song, basically, but I would, like, change the key and change the speed. Because for that whole scene, he just kept doing stuff and showmanship and, like, I'm gonna sell you this and I'm gonna pitch you this. And, like, every single time, I felt like, well, I gotta write music for this part because he's going back into performance mode. So I just kept writing more and more. And listening back to that episode, I actually don't like how it turned out, because there's so much of the same theme over and over. So I think it works much better on the album, where all of that is condensed into one song, because it's a lot more palatable. But it was super fun to write, and one of them I even got to play around with, like, trying to have the Ajax theme work together with Careless Whisper, because Rainer plays it, to get him to tell the truth. So I got to try to see if I could merge those two together, and that was super fun, but again, not gonna work as something I can actually sell. But I really loved, in the Ajax suite, obviously the original is super fast and peppy, but
let's play it. Why are we not playing it?
For sure, I always forget. Oh my god, I gave him an electric guitar intro. I forgot about that. God damn it. I think some of them later on are like, one of them is super slow and much lower because something dumb happened and I wanted to highlight the humor of it. I think one of them isn't even swung. It's just awkwardly, like, very stiff because we're arguing with him and it's a weird, not chill moment. And, like, that whole episode is wild, honestly.
And to think, he would have become...
Yeah.
You could say that with literally any character. Who would have thought that this guy, that this character would have been...
This guy.
The most pivotal.
He came into the story like a fucking tornado. It's absolutely bonkers.
Well, as many of them did.
Yeah, absolutely.
No, I loved this song. This was like, I heard it and I was like, yep.
Oh, I'm glad. Yeah.
That's what I want to talk about.
No, that was super fun. I hadn't tried writing anything like that for our show before, so I'm really glad it worked and the people didn't feel like that totally ruined the mood. That totally took me out of this fantasy medieval story.
Because it's so Azajax. Like, this is, it's just in your face. It's
right.
Loud. It's fun.
Man. Yeah, I'm really glad that didn't take away anything from how crazy of a personality we set him up to be. I'm really glad for that. Yeah, that's the only one for that whole episode.
Yep. Looking at episode 12 and 13, the drinking contest.
Oh, so much fun.
That song's another bop. Get that one.
Yeah, I'll go for it.
Come on, let's go.
Okay. All right.
Because this is also a recurring one for every time we've had a drinking contest.
Yeah.
Except for the one time where it was my bad. Jamie made a song track and I didn't add it. It was in season two, I believe.
I think it was in season two, yeah.
So we'll probably add that to the album anyway and just like, here's
a song
for sure.
Oh, yeah.
In the episode, but we made it.
Yeah, no, that'll be good.
This was another one where I was like, this slaps.
Oh, I'm glad. I don't remember if there's anything... I don't remember if there's anything super specific that went into the writing of this one, but... I mean, obviously you can tell that I had been experimenting a lot with, like, repeating a bit of the melody, but in a different instrument, and, like, I think later on in a couple of these tracks in episode 14, I even messed around with, like, having one headphone be louder than the other, because you can do that. Or not headphones, but you know what I mean, the different...
Yeah, the two different sides.
Yeah, exactly.
Left and right channels.
Channels, that's the word I was looking for, thank you. And in a similar way, this song has like a lot of, the guitar will play a riff, and the flute will play something that's almost the same but not quite, or different things like that.
Because it is
like
a back-and-forth
exactly,
moment in the story.
Right, because it's focused on the two people who are competing, and they're doing almost the same thing, but not exactly, you know?
Yeah.
This was actually like fucking 20 minutes long. Actually, I had to pare it down a lot for the album.
Yeah, because you would score full scenes.
Yeah. And there would be huge moments where in those tracks there would be big moments of silence because, like, obviously I didn't put music in literally every second.
Mm-hmm.
So that when it comes time to put them in the album, I'm getting rid of the silence. I'm getting rid of any repetition. I'm just trying to fit it together to make it like a song that is fun to listen to on its own when the original is meant to be played over your narration and like our talking about what we're doing and all that shit. And like it kind of ends up being two different experiences in a weird way.
Episode 14.
Yeah.
I think it's The Hideout. That's another theme that gets used again later.
It is. It definitely is. I didn't have, like, the cool idea of, like, oh, this should be all weird sevenths, and it should sound like this. The reason it sounds like that is because I just happened to find a kind of instrument in the program that automatically played that weird wobbly seventh thing.
Mm.
So that when I did a couple of them in that pattern, it made this really bizarre, unique sound that I just absolutely loved. But yeah, that has come back.
When did we use? Did we use the Omer
Reeves? I used it for the blades in Costa Rica near the end of the season.
Okay.
But I did take the time. I did, you know, put it in a different key, change the little things about it, add in more like little Costa Rican cues because they're not exactly the same. It just had a similar feel, you know,
of like crime.
A secret organization that like basically runs the city. And also kills people sometimes.
Yes. Yes.
Sometimes. Yeah. And that was super fun because
this was also you started, I think, in Hidgety's when you the Hidgety track. But this is when you started using like the crowd noise.
Yeah. That's in this one right now. Mm-hmm. I think it's in the Hidgety song.
It is. It definitely is. Not right away, but once we get to the part in the story,
where
I talk about there being people.
Yeah. I was lucky enough to find one. I think there's only like the one crowd noise track I've ever used because it's the only one that I felt sounded. It's the only one that I felt sounded like you're actually walking around and you can hear the people around you.
Yeah.
There's another one I've used for like a crowd when you're further away, like in a stadium or something.
Oh yeah.
I think I used that once for the Sun Festival, but
we'll get to that.
Yeah.
Okay, so episode... I'm trying to figure out the right pacing because there's so many songs.
It is.
But
episode it's tricky,
15,
yeah.
There's a lot of them on the album, and this is when we do the whole Mirjik discovery, 15
yep,
and 16.
Yup.
So Mirjik's theme, I think that would be the Orange Sky, right? I think episode 16.
Yes. This is from 16, but we found him at the end of 15.
Yes, yeah, yeah.
So there's another song called The Cow in the Castle at the end of 15, but I don't consider that his theme because it's kind of a generic like pump up song,
yeah.
Like, oh, something's gonna happen. And I mostly wrote that just to be kinda tense. This one is specifically Mirjik.
Okay.
Like
this is his jam.
Everything is in 5 because I took the very simple way of like, oh, how can I make it weird and chaotic? Put it in 5. All of the music, or almost all of it in this song, is based on augmented chords, which just have kind of a stressful sound, honestly. It's not major, but it's not minor. It's major, except one of them is raised up even more, so that the three notes of the chord... I'm not good at... boy.
Basically, they sound spooky.
They sound spooky, yeah, exactly. And what's really cool about those chords is they can just, like... It's the same distance between each note, is what I was trying to say. Mm. Like, the three notes, instead of being, like, a major or minor chord, where you just have them, and then in the next octave you also have the same chord, it's the same distance between them, so it just keeps going up forever. Which gives a really odd sound. I'm kind of repeating myself at this point. But it's fun, and that's why all of Mirjik's music... Say that 5 times fast.
Mirjik's music. Oh, fuck.
Yeah. That's the reason. That's where we got the name Mirjik.
It is.
We were trying to talk about
music wrong.
Yeah. That's why all of this shit sounds so, so weird.
I know. I love this theme.
Yeah.
I'm glad we get to use it a lot more, and we used it a lot in season 2.
Oh, we used it a lot in season 2.
By
so
my request,
much.
I was like, please, I need it. I need that in my life. And Mirjik's. This, because I guess we should probably say, I don't know, but the season 2 theme has a lot of the season 1 motifs in it.
It has
including
a ton.
A little bit of this.
Yep.
And I have a hunch season 3 is going to have a lot more.
Oh, boy, I don't know. I'll jump over to that for a second. I like how it turned out, but it's also a little odd because what I didn't realize when I did this was that every time you start an episode in season 2, you're hearing all of the motifs from season 1,
mm-hmm.
which is fun, but it doesn't, like, fit. It doesn't, like, get you ready for season 2, you know? Mm-hmm. It's
But we also didn't know the season 2 motifs.
Exactly. There's no way I couldn't have written those ahead of time.
Yeah.
So I don't know what I'll do for season 3's theme. Like, I could put in a bunch of the things from season 2... But
my vote is just amp up the Mirjik theme.
It's
just the Mirjik theme.
It's it's just this. Nothing else.
Mirjik would be fine with that.
Yeah.
let's do Grog's theme.
Grog's
episode 18.
Theme.
It's 20 seconds.
Do, 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 do. So dumb.
No, I just want to listen to it. Let's just listen.
Yeah. Wait. All right. There's my hot take. That's not a good song. It's bad. And
oh,
it's not well written.
It is fun, though. It is so fun. Oh, my goodness.
Because that was when we did not...
That's when he was antagonistic.
We couldn't have known.
How are we supposed to know? That Gronk would be a party member.
So that... It's how we were talking about with motifs earlier. Like, what seemed to me at the time, what seemed to me the best opportunity for putting in background music was when you were introducing something new and strange, because one, that gave you more time to talk, so it made sense to put music behind it, and two, something unusual getting music made sense. Because,
like funny.
Yeah, because, like, we're from the perspective of our party, so them discovering something new and weird and having a moment to take it in, it made sense to put music behind that. The problem with that is, again, like we said, it meant, and this is an unintended side effect, that it meant that little weird things that weren't necessarily super important or would come back got themes, while the main characters and the really super important themes didn't get motifs.
Well, what's interesting is the weird, silly little stuff became important.
Yes.
And so they already had themes.
Right. And that's kind of like where I'm going with this, is because like the Grog thing is that problem I just outlined weirdly reversing on itself and going back around to good. Because, like, Grog got a theme when he didn't really matter that much.
But then he became important.
But then he became a party member, and he had a theme. And that was just like, that's perfect, right?
Yep. Wrap it up for this album. Well, I think it was either The Sea Mist Rolls In or The Winds of Change.
The Winds of Change is...
That's when Katrina leaves.
It's Katrina leaving. And that was super interesting because... I felt like it wouldn't work to have music for her leaving and then awkwardly switch back to the ending theme.
Right.
So I tried to, like, write in... That was the first time experimenting with taking the theme and putting it into a new tempo, a new key, all of that stuff. So after all the stuff with Katrina's theme in this song... let's see. This is the theme song for Night's Quest, but it's just in a completely different time signature. Obviously it's lowered a lot. It's made with different music. In different instruments. So that's why... I don't know where I was going with that sentence. It was super fun to write, though.
It did help make it stand out.
I think so.
As a moment.
Oh, yeah. I forgot I did this. Where there would normally be the little bit of ocarina just playing those two notes.
That was the lullaby theme.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Yep, because I figured, like, I like the idea of giving that to Katrina in this moment because it's where it started, you know?
Mm-hmm.
And that's where she was going, to go find her mom.
Find her mom.
Got a little interrupted
on the way, but that's where she was going.
I really liked... I thought it was a really solid place to end album two, which brings us to
Gods and Secrets.
Gods and Secrets. Oh my god!
So now, top of this album, if y'all are opening, and I'm opening them up on Bandcamp and just following along, we got Grog 2 Electric Grogaloo.
We do.
Can we just play that?
Yeah, sure.
Please. I know I already talked about Grog, but come on. Oh, come on.
The same song with like two things added.
A little piano? Come on now. Ooh, tickle those ivories. And here it comes in.
Oh, I forgot about this, yeah.
When did it like drops, doesn't it?
It does, it does. What is that? I think I found a saxophone, maybe?
Oh, there's the upright bass, there it is.
Oh yeah.
Alright, and this is the drop, right?
This one's a lot more major also.
Yeah,
it's good.
All right, let's see what else we got here.
What, there's one called This Time to open up the album, and that was fun too, because that was a chance to, like I said, again, theme song, but to rewrite it as a, like...
Because right, that's when I opened up with Sweeping In Over the City.
Yes. And there must have been something nefarious going on, because it's much more urgent and, like, distressed. Like, ooh, something bad's happening, and we're, like, we gotta hurry up and figure it out.
I think that's when, I almost call him the Keeper, but that's not how Glenn works.
I couldn't tell you. Something's...
Lord Pedric Cartham received a note.
Oh, shit. You're right. That's what was happening in
Higgity. He was reading the note that you wrote.
Yeah! Oh, my God. I thought that was going to be so important, and then it wasn't.
Hey, welcome to Night's Quest.
Welcome to Night's Quest.
That's how it all is. But other than that, we'll probably skip.
We can.
Skip. I don't know. Which one do you think we should jump into next?
Kind of already talked about the big eagle fight.
Yeah, the same theme.
PB's theme comes back a few times in a song called Do Bats Have Heartbeats? Because we thought he was going to die.
Oh, yeah. Was this during the fight?
No, it was afterwards, actually. He had gotten, like, knocked down by a spear or something.
Oh, yes.
Didn't we have to take him to a medic?
Yeah, we took him to the doctor.
We did! That's right! Doctor, my God! There's another kind of fun thing with the... It isn't the end of the Higgity arc exactly, but it sort of feels like...
This is the Higgity theme again.
Yes,
what song did you click on?
This is called A Happy Ending for Almost Everyone. Okay. Because after that big fight... Most of our problems are good for now, and we thought at the
end of this before all the chaos.
At the end of this episode, we thought we had mostly saved the day, quote unquote. And most things were chill, so that's why this song is it's up a step, but it's also a lot slower, and there's a few instruments missing because it's like it's Higgity, things are kind of back to normal, but we're still not totally sure, you know. Mm-hmm. And then, I believe at the end of this one, that's why it's called For Almost Everyone, I think it switches over to... We must see Mirjik doing something, because it...
there it goes. It's changing.
Because it goes into a, a little bit more...
spirit vibe?
Yeah, yeah. Oh, boy. What would he have been doing?
Yeah, that's Mirjik's theme.
Oh, that's Mirjik.
That's Mirjik. Yeah. That's him. Let me pull it up, the episode notes.
In a weird way, writing, it's almost...
This must have been when he was talking with Quist at the end of the episode.
Oh.
And the hell breaks loose.
Oh, yeah, and then it just... And then I just wrote that bit at the end, so it would be easy to link it up to the theme song again.
Yep. That was episode Bird for a Bird, which I don't know if y'all noticed this, but I really enjoy giving clever names.
I think almost every episode title has had at least one pun in it.
Yeah, a pun or a double meaning or an alliteration. So I'm gonna say this right now. I am gonna even be stepping up my hidden meetings in season 3. So,
oh my goodness,
be looking for that.
Yeah,
tease.
I don't think we absolutely need to play them right this second, but there are motifs for the feather farm. I don't know why. And also, inexplicably, I gave an entire motif to the blacksmiths. Like, it kept coming up. It's super short.
Click on that one, because that one's scene, the blacksmith.
Yeah, it's weird. It's also weirdly happy. This has come up, like, 3 times.
Oh, yes.
And, like, the first one... I think I wrote this song because I liked it, and then I was like, where do I put this? I don't know. We need a scene transition. So I just put it after the blacksmith. And then, like, later on in Coasterine, more blacksmith stuff showed up, and I was like, I guess I'll use that again?
Just use it again.
Yeah. So I weirdly put myself into this corner where, like, well, I guess that's the theme of all blacksmiths now. Which is weird because it's not funny or really it doesn't even fit the blacksmiths in any way. It's just weirdly chill.
Ooh, I want to listen to the Burn Shards theme.
Absolutely.
Because I think if I remember correctly, I liked that one.
Wait, I missed something.
What'd you miss?
Oh no. Really quick. Okay, we can go back now. I just wanted to play Ulrich's theme for everybody.
Is that from album two?
Yes.
Okay.
I
skipped that on purpose.
No, it's all good. We don't talk about Ulrich. It's too painful.
Out of the door.
The memories. Shit. Where were
Burn
we?
Charts.
Burn charts.
They were an idea I had long before we recorded Night's Quest. And so I thought, yo, an opportunity to throw the burn shards in, let's do it.
Ooh, gotcha.
And this is before we actually meet them.
This is just someone talking about him. Probably the Black Slash.
Black Slash or Pedgwick describing him.
Yeah.
Yeah, because then we meet him again later. And we use this track, I think.
This actually has some pretty specific... Oh my god, I forgot I wrote this. This has some kind of specific influences for sure, having the very low, ominous synth sounds and like different, almost background tracks, like not strings exactly, but like really, you kind of know what sound I'm talking about.
Filling.
While also there's like very light piano doing its own thing up on top. That is, like obviously... I've heard a lot of songs that use that, but I think specifically, like, some video game soundtracks really influenced me a lot for that one. I can think of some Kingdom Hearts tracks for sure that did a lot of really cool stuff in that vein. And even some of the newer Pokemon games, weirdly enough. Yeah. They've had some very interesting musical ideas. But for sure, the Burn Shards track ended up being very important. Like the Burn Shards themselves came back a few times.
Yes, they did. Nighttime theme.
Nighttime theme. Sure, yeah, why not? If I was
that instrument that was you used that one a lot. That's in the Gorg theme we just listened to. I think Salazar gets it too later.
I'm like 90% sure that is something called trumpet. But it's called trumpet section because it's technically a bunch at the same time. I didn't have the option of doing just a single trumpet, so I had to like find ways to make it.
And then hold on.
Yes. If I was writing that one again, I would definitely make it shorter, or at least have things happen more quickly. But I couldn't quite figure out how to do that for this one. The kids cheering. That was impossible to shorten. I worked on that for a long time. Just like, I just need it to be over quicker. I don't need it to go on for 5 seconds.
It's done.
It couldn't. Like, if I tried to make it shorter, it just made this awful, like, stop-start effect. Yeah, no, it sounded terrible. Yeah. So I just had to leave the whole thing.
Okay, let's move on to album four, The Chaos Games. Kind of like a little transitional.
Real quick.
Gosh.
There's one called Loss. I'm not going to play it right now, but that's one of my favorite songs that I've worked on, and it's come back many times.
Then let's play. If it's one of your favorites, play it.
Okay. It's pretty simple, but it has come back a few times, obviously, when we're in a situation where we have lost someone. It was very first for Grog's cousin, Eddie, and he's learning about it, and he's learning that it was our fault. But
I mean, it wasn't our fault, but like we were
we knew about it. And that we weren't able to save him. And because that scene took the unexpected route of having him like not angry at us, it ended up being a much more bittersweet and like slow song instead of something intense and worried. And I think that worked out well because that's actually come back a few times, again, in other situations where we've lost stuff. Now that I say that, I can't think of any specifically, but that's fine.
It's okay.
Yeah, I guess we're moving on.
Chaos Games. I know, we're like...
Chaos Games.
We're only like halfway through the season and we gotta like fuck all together.
Yeah. We've gotten through 26 episodes and we've got 14 left. I think we'll be all right.
Yeah. It's just, they have a lot of music.
That's true.
Okay, do you want to talk about The Lonely Thief?
Yeah, that one's really cool. I think it's cool. I think it worked out well. It was fun. I hadn't written one of the Ocarina songs from scratch in a while at this point. We had a couple others, but most of them were from much earlier in the season.
Yeah, so like a fresh start.
Exactly, yeah. And I really like, I like some of the weird chords and stuff and how this turned out. I like the ambiance for sure, because the whole point was that Rainer feels so alone and guilty about shit, and like, I think,
is this the one where PB learns
piano? Yeah, it is.
PB learns to play with...
Oh, maybe. It might be. I'm going to skip ahead to the actual ocarina part. I think you're right.
Yeah, because when he wrote this song, it was so that PB would sing with him.
Yeah. And that also is what, boy, PB got a lot of musical focus. Even though he already had the theme about him, he also has this instrument for when it's him actually singing and vocalizing.
Mm-hmm.
And I think, if I'm being honest, I think I went away from that a little bit in Season 2, so that sound has come up in other songs that had nothing to do with him. But for Season 1, at least, that sound was almost always PB singing along with. So that'll show up in
that
some
little,
of the
like,
Costa
ding,
Reed
ding.
Stuff. Yeah, yeah. Those I think sparkles. It was called something harpsichord. That'll come up in some of the Costa Rica stuff for sure.
Was there anything crazy about the twist room?
Nah, to be honest, I just wrote... that was another time where I just tried to make something that sounded spooky and interesting and mysterious. Right. And I like it, but it doesn't have any cool, crazy secrets or anything. Unlike the twist room. Ugh.
Man, wait, that was a drop.
Yeah. Well, I mean... We did our best.
To be fair, we did leave the town, so, you know. And he forgot his everything.
Yeah,
honestly, I think that was a saving grace, having Leroy forget. Because I feel like he had reached, like, the peak of his plot line.
Oh,
and so
I gotcha.
To have him, like, have to start over. So, Season 3, he'll probably have to, like... We'll have to move on, because he's kind
of remembered a lot of that. That's a good point. Hey, speaking of people forgetting their memories, this song is just straight up called Memories. I'm stopping here because this one I have used a few times. I think I even used it in the finale of Season 2. This came back for when we were able to save Quis, and like actually Quis himself was back, you know?
Mm.
And I thought that was really fun because I hadn't gotten a chance to use this song again since at least I don't think I had. In like 50 episodes, so it was really cool to come back to this one and try to change it up a little bit and put it into a new context. But yeah, this one is obviously just flute and that acoustic guitar.
Right.
While there is also a third track, I believe it's just the sort of faint, like sort of wobbly music in the background you heard at the beginning of the track. But it's mostly just these two, and that was kind of fun to work on because a lot of the other tracks I tried had so many different moving parts, and I think sometimes that can get really overwhelming, especially when it's supposed to be background for people talking, you know?
Mm-hmm.
So having just a couple of things, and there's that third instrument I don't know how to describe, but having just a few things instead of a lot was really in some ways, it's actually easier, and I like how it turned out. Boy, I need to find a new way to end these little speeches.
Just stop.
Yeah.
Just stop. Yeah.
Moving
just stop
on.
Talking.
Yeah.
Okay. There's a lot of songs in 28. Are there any that you want to hit on? Otherwise, I want to get to Gorfball.
I'd say no. Salazar's Lament. That's just loss again. But then there's some fun Katrina stuff at the end of it. If you go listen to it, you'll recognize those themes.
Yeah, I feel like we're now preparing and be like, listeners, find the motifs. Where
yep,
are they?
Yep.
How often do we use this same track?
Yeah,
a lot.
Once we get to Gorfball, there are a couple Mirjik tracks. But again, it's just the Mirjik motifs again. So it's. In a weird way, it's kind of no big deal. And then we get to Gorfball.
Gorfball.
Love Gorfball.
Gorfball.
Yeah, yeah.
Run it.
Yes. I was so happy with this. Because, once again, just like we were talking about with the Zajax, it's a very different sound. But I thought... I felt confident taking a chance on that because it's a very different scene. Mm-hmm. Like, we hadn't had any sort
I know,
of...
we had, like, announcers
yeah.
and, like...
Yeah,
oh,
yeah.
Oh, there it is, there it is.
The whole time I was just trying to emulate, like, fucking, I don't know, some kind of sports anime or something. like, let's do this. It has to be out there. There's going to be, like, crowds. I think in one of these there even is a crowd noise.
Yeah, there's definitely crowd noises.
What was kind of fun was this is the music playing behind round one. And if I remember right, this is also the track where Rainer loses horribly. There's a lot of key changes. That's kind of neat. Let's see. No, I gotta find it. Shut up. Yep. Oh, that's definitely Rainer losing. Yep. Yep. It just tapers off into nonsense. When we get to the semifinal song, which is this one, I thought that was... the first one was in 3, this one's actually in 4. But it's pretty much the same song, but obviously in a different time signature.
Key change.
Yeah. More key changes for sure.
Get the key change! You gotta feel it! Oh, I feel Bjorn Bjornsson coming out of me right now. Just
like, yeah.
And now we're watching the game.
He was announcing, right?
Yes, yeah.
Yeah.
Him and Taylor.
It was fun trying to map those to the audio because there was obviously a lot of you describing what happened, and Jake too, both of you guys describing what's happening on the field. But there would also be moments where we stopped to like roll dice and stuff, and I didn't feel like it was appropriate to have it just keep going like crazy, so I had to like bring everything down and try to make it work. That's why some of these tracks suddenly get really quiet, and then out of nowhere they come back, like, again, key change. But it's the same song. Yeah, yeah.
There it is.
I don't think there's anything crazy in... There's 2 tracks for Rainer talking with Mirjik. I don't think there's anything super interesting or secretive, so I'm going to skip
jingle.
Those. I'm skipping to final round, which we'll play for just a second. That's after we leave Mirjik. Again, it's just the same song. Yeah. This one, there is something really fun about this one, though. Because I apologize for the skipping. But while it's getting kind of quiet here. Okay. Yep. It's building up a little bit again because some stuff is going on. Jake, what did you roll? Jake, tell us what you rolled. You guys aren't going to believe me. It was a nat 20. Oh, I had the timing kind of off, but whatever. That's why it got quieter again here. Because Jake is rolling and he's laughing to himself and we're all asking him, like, Jake, what the fuck? And then they win the game. Yeah, so everything comes back like crazy. Jingle Jangle is just We're Going Places With Better. That's it.
Yes.
Yeah. Shit. That's not what I meant to do.
No. I want to hear it again.
Sure.
Yes. Ba-bum, 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 ba-bum.
Right. Alternately, everything's better with better. We're still not 100% sure which one it is,
we're
but that's okay.
We're going places with better.
Yeah.
Everything's better with... Okay. Anything else from this album?
Nah, I don't think so. There's a...
Play Lonely Thief again.
Yep.
Go to a party.
Yep.
Rainer almost, there's... like, fucking leaves.
Yeah, yeah.
Everyone high and dry.
I'm glad it didn't... I'm glad I didn't do that. I'm glad that bad idea
was... Can you
imagine
that story? Can you imagine that story?
Because, like, you guys didn't, like, forbid me from doing it or anything, but no. There definitely was a sense of, like, okay, are you sure?
I'm like, man, like, are you're doing this? You're just leaving everyone right now?
Just take a second to think about this. So there's a couple of pretty chill tracks that we're trying to play on that emotion, and it would take forever to play them right now, so I'm not going to.
Let's move on to the final songs.
We're moving on to...
I do not have in front of me, so you're gonna have to run this part of the...
Hell yeah.
Which there's so many songs I want to get to and we're already over time.
Okay.
But no, you know what? This is our podcast. Fuck you. We'll talk as long as you want.
There's a lot of songs. There's not a ton. There's some songs while we're just on the road to Coasterine.
Did we give Eloise and Bathilda a theme?
Not specifically, no.
Okay, so let's jump to the heat of it.
Sure.
Oh, Great City.
Oh, Great City, yeah.
So this was one of those moments where I knew we were gonna be.
Sorry. No, it's okay. No, this track, this relates, I promise.
Okay. Where I knew we were going to be... Oh, I know which one that is now. Yeah, I know which one that is. So I knew we were going to be doing this scene of singing the song. And I was like, yo, what if we had the Oh Great City theme just be the Coast Dream theme?
Right.
So we were far enough ahead that we had already recorded or sung that song. And so I was like, Jamie, wedge that in early so it makes it look like we knew what we were doing.
Yeah. I don't think we had the completely 100% finished. No,
but we knew
the
melody of it.
Exactly. So I was able to
so this is the one when we first arrived to the city.
Yep. And I was able to.
So this is my first time actually hearing this song that I had made up in my head. Which is wild.
Yeah, yeah.
So right here. I think I like this version more.
Oh, okay.
Then the final one
with singing and
with the singing.
Interesting.
Partly maybe it's just because maybe I'm like, oh, I didn't like my singing because I was singing in character, and that was, we'll get to that.
That's always.
But this version, I don't know. It just feels right, and so I genuinely listen to this at work, like on repeat. I would skip to the good part.
Oh my god, that was so fun to work on because the episode itself had such a moment of hype there because we're finally getting to this city that we've heard so much about, and it was really cool. I really enjoyed trying to replicate that in the music because like these characters have been hearing so much about Coast Dream forever,
Coast Dream.
And they're finally getting there, and there's this really wonderful moment of seeing it for the first time. And we did something we don't usually do, which is we actually let this music keep going, and we dropped out the audio, even though it wasn't a scene change.
Yeah.
And I really love how that turned out.
It's coming. Here it goes. Oh, hear the twang? Here it comes.
Oh, man. This is making me so happy. Thank you. Thank you for remembering the twang.
There's no twang the second time. I knew that.
Oh my goodness.
So yeah, this song gets me hyped.
Good. I'm really glad, man. Oh, that's super fun.
So I was like, wow, this song that I thought of is a song now. That's cool. But this isn't even the song version.
Right, that's okay,
so
not
what, before we get to the final version, were there any other songs? I can't remember. I
don't have the list in front of me. Let's see. Yeah. I mean, obviously there are tracks here, but I don't have a burning desire to talk about them.
Did we give Wallace a theme?
I don't think so.
That'd
be fun, though. There's
performance a theme?
I forgot this was here. There was a scene transition in episode 33 where Jake made a joke about the song Work Bitch. So I remade that part of that song and put it in as a scene transition. I'm not selling it, but this is what it sounds like. Okay, we're done with that. That's enough of that. Moving on. Let's see. We have our lovely trumpets.
Yes.
That was really funny to
show. I think
show...
that was something we made that sound effect, and then you turned it into a song.
Jake, just as a goof, he was like, oh, there's trumpets. And I was like, I bet I can...
I can match that.
I can make that. Yeah. Why not? Let's do it.
Which was not the first time you had to match...
Yeah.
A song that we make.
Yeah. He was very surprised to hear that. That was super fun. I gave Noble Mincer a theme, but it didn't... which sounds fine on its own, and it's doofy and funny, but I did not realize that it's way, way too low to actually hear it when it's put into an episode. Mm. So unfortunately, when you listen to the episode, this... barely comes through. I mean, it sounds kind of fun on its own, to be honest, but not so much. That's why I needed to retool that for another appearance at the end of the season.
Yes, which is still one of my proudest moments. Shoehorning him into episode 40.
So funny! Oh my goodness!
I really feel like he was like a weird. Like I don't want to say an antagonist to Rainer, He was, but he was also, like, the motivator to get Rainer to ways, do shit.
For yeah. sure. Absolutely.
And so to have him be there at the end and be like, oh, you little boy.
Well, if you think about it, that's those two things are exactly what he was in episode one.
Mm-hmm.
He was both the person I was, quote-unquote, playing against, but he also was saying, like, yeah, what are you doing? Like, come on, let's go, chop, chop. Like, yeah. choose something.
Yeah, do something.
So both of, it's kind of funny that both of those characteristics came back later.
Yeah, and he resolves that in the end of the...
Yeah. Gosh. Absolutely.
The more people keep saying Noble Mensa for season three, the more I'm like, how can we get this guy over
I wasn't going to say it, but...
how can I make it not be... so we have 11 fucking characters in the party.
No, you don't need to make him part of the party. Although, you could. You could give him a character sheet.
Oh, that's my too God. Much. He doesn't deserve that.
There's a couple of tracks with the Amulet of Chance that always has a really fun, like...
swirling effect?
Yes. That is literally... I just took one of the dozen different, like, synth sound options, and I just copy and pasted it, like... 30 times in a really short span. So it's the equivalent of like hitting a piano and then running your hand along all the keys, right? So that's literally all that is for the Amulet. It comes up a bunch. I'm the only reason I'm skipping these is because, again, they're not super interesting to talk about. I am proud of them and I do like how they sound. So once this fifth album comes out, definitely check it out.
Check it out. Which is right now.
We've got... Do you want to listen to the song version of O Great City? Or would you rather use our time...
I mean, I guess, is there anything else to talk about that the making of that process of that song?
Yeah, we can do that for sure. Because...
So it started off with... Yeah. I came up with the song myself. You know, the lyrics.
The actual lyrics, yep.
And I guess the melody.
Oh, the melody,
that,
for
that
sure.
go with it. And I think I recorded myself singing it.
I believe
and
so, yeah.
making a percussion to it.
Oh, right. For to actually keep the time.
Yeah, the time. And I was like, this is kind of how I feel like the beat to the song goes. And I sent that to you.
Yes.
This was before we lived together, so we weren't able to, like, collaborate.
Oh, that's right. That was back... That was a while ago. Yeah. And that it was good to have that, because I could literally just plug that into the program so that I could listen to that while I'm also working on music for it and just line everything up.
Yep.
And in that way, it was actually super convenient. Because I could... whenever I could also take all the pauses between the phrases and the singing, and I could just chop those up so I could move them around if I needed to and stuff.
I felt really weird. I recorded this song... and I didn't feel like I could actually project all the way because there was, like, other people in the house. And I didn't
want
to be,
yeah,
like,
yeah.
super loud. So part of me is like, I could probably do a better version than the one in this, you know, if I were to do it again. But also I'm like, it doesn't matter.
Right.
So I'm a lot happier with the Ancient Ooster Dungeon song.
Yeah, I think so.
No, I do like the actual song. Like the beat to it and everything.
God, I haven't listened to this in a while. Cause we were,
cause this is PB singing too, and we got Eloise's flute, the ocarina,
yes,
and
okay.
the drum, and the singing.
Who's singing?
Bathilda sings.
Bathilda sings,
while she plays the drum.
Yes, that was it. Yes, okay.
That's why I sang.
That's also why there's two flute tracks, because one of them is, one of them is lower in the register of what an actual flute would sound like, and the other one is higher to sort of half-heartedly recreate what an ocarina would sound like.
And I think PB's in there, too.
I believe so, yes.
Yeah. Because he was part of the band.
If he's not in this one, he's definitely in the Fairy Slipper, which...
Oh, yeah, I forgot about the Fairy Slipper.
Yeah. We're really close. We've only got, like, 4 episodes left.
Yeah, that
oh yeah, yeah.
It is weird to listen to yourself singing.
I haven't done it in a while, but I 100%.
I'm used to listening to myself talking, but
yeah,
to myself because
yeah.
you know for editing. But now the singing, you're like, ooh, you're dangly. You should have.
Yeah,
you didn't hit that note right.
No, it's always a little weird because you notice like 100 things that
yeah.
other people probably aren't going to notice.
They're not going to notice, but you're like, oh, it's me singing, and oh, I don't like that, or I do like that.
I'm just gonna leave this playing while I talk. This is the bad ending.
I loved the bad ending.
It was actually pretty easy to make because I just had to go through and, like, I knew which notes it would be to change everything to minor chords, so that didn't take terribly long.
It was such a great moment to just be like,
because
this is, I think, when did we first play the bad ending?
I don't know. It's episode 36, but I don't know exactly why.
That might be when Leroy lost his memory or when Quist became Conquist. Let me look that up.
Oh, yeah, I bet it was Quist. Because there was that fucking incredible moment where he said, I think I'm going to rewrite this character. And it just got, like, lower and lower and more creepy. And that made this work super well.
Yes, yeah, that's when it was. Yeah, that was just such a cool way. Because, it felt weird to end on a happy note, because, this is bad.
Yep.
This is very bad. And so, there's been lots of moments where we could have used a minor key in Season 2, but I kind of like the idea of reserving it for Murgic.
Yes.
Like, only Murgic
shenanigans
to use the minor key.
I hear that.
You'll note that it only comes after...
I think only when Murgic just completely throws everything to the wind. Yeah,
his forte
for sure.
Which
I won't play
this?
The whole thing, but this is the Fairy Slipper.
Oh yeah.
It was really cool having this after O Great City, because writing O Great City, I was trying to think of, like, instead of being background music, this is literally.
A song.
Yeah, it's happening in the story. I think there's a word for that in, like, in film scoring and stuff, but I can't remember it right now. Like, instead of... Yeah, I just said that. But the cool thing was, I was... In O Great City, it was, like, supporting the vocals, and, like,
mm-hmm.
everything else was meant to lift that up and be kind of around that. So when I was working on the Fairy Slipper, it was kind of cool that the main melody of the song was also something I was making up, you know?
Mm.
So, like, I got to kind of make everything from the ground in that case. And, like, technically they're both flute sounds, but in the story it's an ocarina and a flute. And they kind of trade the melody back and forth, and, like, the drum and PB are sort of building around that just like they were in O Great City. And it was just super cool to work on the two songs in that order, because I got to try two very different things. And both times, it's actually happening in the story, so I don't have to worry about it being too overpowering or distracting from the words or anything. In some ways, this was, like, the most fun to write.
Yeah,
because
you're just writing a song.
Yeah.
Just write, like, a normal song?
100%. Let me see here.
Anything else before Double Fools?
Poor old Genshin. God, I gave Quist... Quist had some really dark moments, like when he tried to fucking fireball everybody.
Just the burn shards.
Just the burn shards, that's true.
They deserve it. They're dicks.
This is a song. There's a track in here for the giant manticore monster.
Chimera?
The chimera, yeah.
Come on, boy.
I will never remember the right word. I think I brought a version of this back for the monster in the dungeon in season 2. that was fun. But yeah, once this album is out, take a listen to that one, because we're skipping it.
It's out right now. They can go listen to it right now.
This is Quiz. This is called Quiz's style, because everybody had a style.
Oh yeah.
And his was blotting all the light out of the sun and just causing general havoc at the Sun Festival.
Which now I realize is very thematic to take the sun away from the Sun Festival. I had not put two and two together on that.
To be totally honest, I don't know if I had until just now. while I was saying it. I believe I brought this back.
This does sound familiar.
You know what I think I brought it back for is the scene in the Omeris Conservatory where Katrina is just straight up like, no, I'm going to kill him.
Yeah.
and we had to worry about the King Lily because that was potentially going to kill someone. And I don't remember what Rainer's doing. He's sneaking around in there for some reason.
Yeah.
But it was just a very tense scene where we're like, someone could definitely die in this scene, and it's gonna be me if I'm not careful. That's not exactly the same feeling that we have at this moment in episode 37, but I figured it was similar.
It worked well. It worked well.
Let's see here. I love The Ship's Highway, but it's a very slow song. I'm not going to play it right now. I think this... Well, there's the trumpets again. But I think this is when... This is called Your Entertainment, and it's when the king is going to execute those people.
Yeah.
And I think... I think I put in O Great City again. Because I thought I was being... I thought I was being super edgy and, like... It really makes you think, doesn't it? Like, it's, like, deep. Is it in here?
Yep, yeah.
Oh, yeah, it is! That was
this
fun.
Track too.
Because that was when people fucking died.
Yeah. Like, that's when the burn charts executed supposed Poolish.
Oh, yeah! I could remember that it was like people the king wanted dead, but I didn't remember exactly why. Yikes. And the slippery one.
The slippery one. Did he survive?
Yeah.
No one knows. Will he come back? Right away to Rillian.
We're real, real close. I think. See,
I think the edgy works.
I'm really happy with how the giant, like, grand cinematic version of Careless Whisper. I'm really happy with how it turned out. Can't sell it, but
it was a dope track.
I was really happy with it.
Like, you were like, because we've done it a few times, so you were like, how can I make this amazing? Was this the Nat 20 roll, or was that the
first
one?
It was probably Nat 20, yeah. No, I went in, like, I listened to that song obsessively for a few weeks.
I listened to the song obsessively just because I like the song. That's why it's in this show.
Oh, well, thank you, but I meant the actual Careless Whisper.
That's what I meant. Like, I listened to the normal Careless Whisper. It's on my playlist
in
life.
It's a good song.
And when the reason it's in episode whatever, because I wrote down a bunch of my favorite goofy songs, and that's the one the dice picked.
Of course, of course.
Come on now. No, George would be proud.
I grabbed, this was the first time I used anything besides that saxophone riff. I actually used, like, the melody from the verses.
Yeah.
And some stuff from the chorus. It's, like, this is definitely a cover. So that's the reason I don't know if I'm allowed to... Maybe I can...
Maybe we'll do, like, a covers album and just have it be free?
Yeah, there's gotta be a way, right?
There's gotta be a way.
Like...
I'm just like, George Michael, please. Please, George Michael.
I'll just reach out to my buddy George.
Mr. Michaels. We made a pretty version of your song.
This is like a depressing song, too.
Oh, it is.
It got the weird meme recognition of being, like, a sexy song, but it's sad. It's all about how he lost this person, and he regrets how he...
I'm never
going to
dance again.
Yeah. Guilty feet have got no rhythm. It's all about how he lost this person, and he regrets all his actions, and somehow the internet was like, that's a horny song for sure.
I know you're not a fool.
It's good. It's a good time.
Should've known better than to cheat a friend and waste the chance that I'd been given. So I'm never... Oh, you changed some notes.
It's possible I did. It's also possible I just straight up got it wrong.
Either way, it was intentional.
Sure.
All right, let's go to Gentian.
The Tragedy of Gentian. The correct one will always be labeled on here as Volume Patch 2, because...
because it was... Yeah. The music was too loud, couldn't hear the vocals.
Yep. Yeah, I had to retool that a few times.
Again, this is another one of those times where I was like, I'm not hugely fond of how the vocals turned out on my end. Like, I sang this in the car, like, a billion times to, like, figure out the lyrics.
Yep.
And, like, just because I thought they were fun songs. But then when I sat to record them, I don't know if it was just my posture or maybe because I'm trying to sing as a female. I don't know.
Right. The one thing that I already kind of mentioned was like, oh yeah, when you listen back to your own voice on recording, you always pick out stuff about it. Another thing I think, and I'm kind of spitballing here, so this might sound dumb, but I think, like, anyone who records themselves singing, the only context we have for listening to people sing is, like, mostly pop stars and celebrities who have tons of money, who have tons of technology to make their voice sound as perfect as they can make it.
Yeah.
So I think when we hear normal people singing, it's very tempting to just be like, oh my god, I sound terrible, you know?
But I do... No, I'm just kidding.
No, Nathan!
I think, though, I do like... I mean, I said this already, but I liked how the dungeon...
And we don't have that voice stuff and that technology stuff,
yeah. I like how the dungeon song turned out better.
Yeah!
That's because I think I was able to really make the character voice be a part of the song.
I think so.
And I think that added to it.
It would have sounded much less
if it didn't have that accent and that voice, it wouldn't
have been the same song. It would have just been like, oh, why are you singing a cover of fucking the Ustra Dungeon?
Yeah.
But
otherwise, I thought the music for it turned out really good, and it made a great dramatic moment in the story
for
to just kind of like
Ustra Dungeon?
No, this song.
Oh, this,
sorry, this
for
song.
Sure.
Just to give, like, a fuck you to the game.
Yeah!
Through music.
Well, like, we kind of knew what we were doing was a bad idea. And I feel like that really amped up the emotion of the scene, just like you said.
Genshin 2 was one of those moments. I remember because you were asking for songs.
Yeah.
And so I knew the history of Glenwood.
Yeah.
And I wanted to try to, like, I thought... So folk songs were better, you know, of like the tales. And so I was like, well, here's a moment in the history of Glenwood that I think is what you're describing.
Make and then make them twice.
I did like that moment.
That was good. I really love the addition of basically any lore that isn't, like, it's not 100% connected to what we're doing right this second, but we're learning more about the world we're in. I just adore that, especially if it's in a different way, like this song or something, you know? I think that just gives such a variety to the episode, and it really works well.
Flavor and stuff. Yeah. And it just gives us a lot of bases for, like, hey, if we ever want to do more one-shots, oh, we can go here and talk about this then, or...
Yeah, yeah.
Let's go talk to Genshin or something, I don't know.
We are on the very last episode of Season 1.
Wow, we're almost
done. Season 1 is all we're talking about for today, so we're getting to the end. This is the beginning, and I love it a lot, because Nathan sets up this beautiful sweeping vista, and he's describing the whole city and all this stuff, and then Jake just fucking cuts him off. We stop the music.
The amount of moments, times we do that with the music, beautiful description, and then...
And then Nathan is like, fine, we're not doing it anymore. And Jake is like, no, shut up. Jamie, bring the music back in. So like, of course I did. Like, we just made that work. We wrote it in. It's so much fun to... I absolutely adore working on any musical moments that we talk about.
In the episode?
Yeah, to make it come to life later on is so... It's so dumb, but it's so funny. And I just really love it.
I know, the music it does a weird balance of, like, adding ambiance and making serious moments serious and moody moments moody, but also being part of the gag and part of the jokes.
Music cutting off suddenly is the funniest fucking thing in the world. Like, it shouldn't be, because that means I have a very easily amused brain, but it really is. Like, for some reason, I couldn't tell you why, but it's... I probably do it too often, but it's super fun.
It is I was about to say, like, yeah, that's a very used joke, and I'm like, Nathan, anytime you say the word better, you can't stop yourself from dying and wheezing.
It's true. It's true.
Or, like, in the bonus episode with the pumpernickel, that got me every time. Every time I laughed. I'm laughing now thinking about it.
Of course. The reason I let this track keep
going...
Which
motif is this?
This is Great City.
Yeah, okay.
Because this is our last... this is the last episode where we're taking a big, grand look at the city before we zoom in on the party.
Yeah, and stuff.
Yeah. I thought it'd be kind of cool to go back to that motif again for... Because that's Coastarine's theme, really, more or less. And then I think this is...
What theme is this?
This is Genshin, I think. But obviously, it's way different and stylized and, like, kind of chopped up a little bit.
I like this, too.
The scene must have shifted a little bit.
I think we're describing, like, the shit you're in.
Probably. Yeah. Because it would have been a whole... I love that you can remember,
that's,
yeah.
That's Genshin.
Yeah, because for listeners, it would have been a whole week since they had heard all that stuff, you know? So, that's the intro for the finale episode. Whoa, God.
What was that?
God, it's so loud.
This is called Genshin Stinger.
This is called Insurance. I guess I must have
talking about Bathilda.
Yeah. I must have set this up while the king was giving that ultimatum of like, this is how it's gonna go.
That was a great moment. I don't know if we talk about this in any of the night times, but that was a great moment for me to just be like,
okay,
adding stakes to this story that we didn't really have.
I hear you.
As a result of the dice and obviously setting up all of season two
for sure
on that. Okay. Was there anything else other than the ending?
Real quick.
Oh yeah, the blades.
This is just called the House of Many Doors because that's the name of the building. But I don't think we'll be able to hear it because I'm not going to listen to 4.5 minutes of this. But it's the Coin Rat's hideout theme. But instead of the little melodies for each of the coin rats, because there was one for the eagle, one for the one for the whoever, and
Mark
one
and
for
Mark and the rat,
one for the analyzer guy. Instead of those, it's little bits and pieces from all of the Coasterine songs, and I thought that worked. I thought that was really fun. It would take me forever to find them, so I'm just gonna move on. You'll be able to hear it if you go listen to the album.
Go get to do it.
Don't
do it.
What is... Oh, this is when we're saying goodbye to Ulrich. Oh, no.
Yeah, because this is the Hidgety theme for Ulrich. Yeah.
Oh, that was so sad. We got to see him again, and then he vanished from our lives.
I feel like that was the whole of that arc. Was just bringing back... Hey, remember Noble Mincer? He's back. Remember Ulrich? He's back. Remember Katrina? Guess what? She's back. Which I guess, to be fair, we did that in season two as well.
Oh,
we
for
just,
sure.
We just like to bring everybody back in for the finales.
This must be... I'll tell you what this is called in a second. This is when everyone is gathering near the boats.
Mm-hmm.
And it's really dramatic and it kind of sad because like Bathilda just got locked up. And in a way, we don't really know exactly what we're doing. And we're starting this huge adventure that we're like very unprepared for. And everyone's... Like, we finished one part of this journey, but we're also forced into starting a new one, and Rainer certainly doesn't have any idea how to feel, so it's this weird kind of bittersweet moment. But then... Noble Mincer shows up.
Noble Mincer.
So this track is just called Hello, Rainer. And it was... If I may just... compliment you for a second here. It was the best setup because Rainer was talking to someone and then Leroy leans over the edge of the boat and he says, hey, hey Rainer, we need to get going. Come on up here as soon as you're done talking to Noble. And Rainer said, what? Hello, Rainer. And that was, of course, it was so easy to make the music fit that because it was just such a good setup already.
But it also wasn't the only time we had a random character pop up in the last couple minutes.
Speaking of that, we're on the very last song of this entire iTunes playlist because that's what we're using here because we're professionals.
Professionals.
This song is 7.5 minutes long because it was a big ending scene.
Yeah, it was like our ending with an ending of an ending scene.
Yeah. I thought it would be kind of fun to try to put this in. Technically, it's in 9 because I thought that would give it a really good feeling of moving forward. Because now we're finally set up, and we're like, here we go. We're knights, and this is our quest. I think.
I know.
Is the
joke we're making that joke. Yeah.
So we're like finally feeling like this is happening. Let's do it. Season 2, baby. And I like, I definitely like how this song turned out.
That was a little Mother's Lullaby right there, wasn't it?
Was it?
Yeah.
Oh boy, it might have been. I hate that it's getting to the point where I honestly can't remember. I would love to say I've kept perfect track of all the motifs in all these songs, but I'm not. Unfortunately, I have not. A lot of other stuff. Some kind of emotional moments. I don't think this is anything specific. I think this is just new music. Boy, this sounds familiar, but I genuinely don't know if I used it from some other track I already made. Okay, whatever. We have this really cool, we're feeling it, we're moving forward, everything is exciting, and then, obviously, like, I felt like we really wanted to pull out all the stops, like, make this an intense but still hopeful and exciting way to end the season, so I was really kind of doing my best with this whole setup, and then it got quiet for a while. I don't want to skip too far.
Oh yeah, there it is. I'm so proud of this, dude. Yes, there he is. I love it, love it, love. So I really wanted him to come with, because I'd fallen in love with this character that had,
of course,
just been like. This is also the tempo I associate him with now. Oh, okay. In the original version, it's a slower tempo.
It's a little slower, yep.
But I think from now on, he had a quicker tempo in
probably
season two.
Yeah, I think that's right, if I remember right.
Gosh, little did I know that Zajac's coming along in this boat.
Yeah.
And then what was this track?
This is just... this is just the swung chill version of Mother's Lullaby, which I started calling home. Mm-hmm. This version of it first played when we got back from Hidgety, because there was that long stretch of time, and then we were traveling, and then like finally getting back, and it was raining, and everyone was there waiting for us, and like putting the song of Rainer's parents, more or less. Mm-hmm. So whenever this song is in major, I associate it with Rainer's parents, pretty much, is the takeaway here. And the reason it's playing now is because at the end of that season, we actually took a very brief scene to see Bjorn
getting
the letter. Yeah.
And Bjorn ends each season.
Yeah, he does. He does. It always comes back to Bjorn.
Starts with Bjorn?
It starts with Bjorn.
Ends with Bjorn.
He's the first person to say anything.
He is.
He's the first line of dialogue. Yeah, yeah.
And he gets the last line of dialogue.
Exactly, yeah. So I really wanted to bring that theme back, obviously, because I feel like that theme is almost more emblematic of the show than even the actual theme song. Mm. It's just gotten so... It's become so much of a symbol in the story. So I really wanted to find a way to use that again. It's also one of the only songs I... am even halfway decent at playing on a piano in real life, because I just really love it, and I love how the chords turned out with this major version, and I don't know, that has become very, very special to me. And that's it.
That's
you
it.
Guys,
that's
we got to the end
one.
Of the season. Yeah.
So thank you everyone for listening to our, I'm looking at my timer, probably around 90 minutes of rambling about our music. So thanks.
It was a lot.
Thanks for listening to that.
Yeah.
You're great. I don't know what the announcements are, so we'll probably fade out and then I'll come back in with the actual announcements afterwards. But I'm going to save myself the time later. Go get the music.
Yeah.
Go get the music.
For the people who have already bought these albums especially, seeing that people actually went and downloaded them was... I don't know if I can describe how excited that, like, it's one thing to, like, obviously we know people are listening to the podcast, but I definitely wasn't sure if anyone particularly cared about the music. And we're talking, this was a while ago, because obviously I do know that now. But to see that people actually did want to support the show and wanted to listen to the music really hit me in such a way. I don't know how to describe it. Like, it was something special.
It hit different
in 2020. And
this was way before 2020.
Yeah. And you guys are amazing. And thank you so much for listening to this episode. Yeah. And it means a lot.
So if you want to go listen to the music, they're all on Bandcamp of season one. And as always, if you liked this or you liked the music, we'll maybe do it for season two. That's like a whole million years away. But I would love to get the season two music
Up
online as well. Just because there's some slaps in there too. Oh, yeah, boy. Yeah. Oh, boy. But that'll be... At the rate we go,
looking forward to it.
It'll be a hot minute, so because we have lives and jobs and the actual episode to score.
Yep.
Season three. Oh, that's gonna be nuts.
Season three. Six seasons in a movie. Nope, that's a different.
Nope,
thing.
Nope. That's it. We're not doing
completely unrelated. Yeah.
Not us. Nope. Yeah. Not no way. All right. So that's the bonus episode. Bye.
Goodbye.
Goodbye. And you'll hear me again after the theme song.
Yep. So I love you.
Don't leave. Oh, thanks.
The specific person listening to this, I love you.
Hey, Questies, it's me, Nathan. Thank you for listening to that bonus episode about our music conversation. I enjoyed having that talk with Jamie, and I hope you enjoyed listening to it. Again, that album is called Oh Great City. It's the fifth one, and it's available at knightsquestofficial.bandcamp.com. You can buy the thing for only a dollar or more if you want to do that. And, of course, that money goes to help fund this podcast, because it does cost money to do that. So thank you for all of you who have been supporting that. Some announcements, one that you'll definitely want to hear. In 2 weeks, the next one that's going to come up, the next bonus episode that is going to come up, is going to be some unreleased bloopers. There's a lot of bloopers that I didn't put at the end of the episodes, partly because some of them weren't crazy funny or just required a lot of context, or maybe there was just funnier ones in the episode. So I'm going to release those, explain some of them if I need to, or just throw some of them at you without context because they're funnier that way. So look forward to that one. It probably won't be a whole hour. I haven't quite edited it yet, but you'll get what you get, all right? And so that'll be available in 2 weeks. Another bonus episode that I have in the works as we develop season three is one where I want you, yes, you, the listener, to be a part of the episode. If you've ever wanted to actually be in a proper Night's Quest episode, this is your chance. What I'm thinking of is I've got a list of questions that I want you to answer as the audience. Some of them include your impressions of some of the characters, some of your thoughts, what would your character in Night's Quest be if you were playing. Just some silly questions. So if you are interested in being in that episode, there's a couple ways you can let me know. The first is by just sending us a message on our Instagram, knights.quest, or on our Facebook, knights.quest.podcast. Just say, hey, I want to be in the bonus episode, and we'll send you the questions that you need to answer. The second way that you can get involved is by sending us an email at knights.quest10@gmail.com. That's knights.quest10@gmail.com. And again, just send us an email saying, I want to be in the episode, and we'll send you the questions. It's not going to be a ton of work, and you are going to need to record your answers and send us that audio file. It does need to be a great microphone, but do try to make it as nice sounding as possible, and we will edit those together to create an episode made by the fans. So that'll be cool. So that's a bonus episode that we have in the pipelines. Otherwise, that's about all I've got. Season 3 is still in the process, so you'll know when it's ready. You'll know. We want to make sure it's good. Otherwise, thank you so much for listening. Tell your friends, leave a good review, and may your place in his story be long. Oh, and there's no blooper at the end of this one, because we did it all in one beautiful take. So, instead of a blooper, you get me making a fart noise. That's it. Bye.